Good morning, everyone, and welcome to a new lecture within our Jean Monnet Open Online course of European Integration, which this year is specially focused on the topic of economic development. Today is a very special day in our course because you know what happens? That I am a little bit bored. I'm a little bit bored of doing every week the same thing. Yes? In the beginning, it was good. It was because it was something new. But now everything is going so well. Everything is like going on wheels. And I'm getting bored. And this is nothing bad to get bored. The good thing about getting bored is that I'm already thinking about organizing something new. Because I do not like routine in this sense, like repeating every week the same thing for 3 years in a row. So we have to do something new. I also have some news. We have started also an open online course of Ukrainian language and culture. And we are already in the third week of this course. This is something new. It's more exciting for me because it's something we have never done before. And this course is important also because, unlike the courses that we have today, this does not receive any external funding or any external support by external agencies. So it is completely autonomous. It is our course for us. Yes? And this course is going very well. I'm really happy about that. I also received yesterday this book, which is the book that we use for this course. It's called Beginner's Ukrainian by Yuri Shevchuk. And it's a very thick book, a very nice one, you see, with pictures and so on. Shevchuk used to teach Ukrainian language and culture in the summer school of Harvard University, and then he moved to the University of Columbia in New York. And this book is really, really good. But what is important is not the book itself. What is important is that Ukrainian language is important, but mostly Ukraine is important, irrespective of the language. Yes, doesn't matter if you speak Ukrainian, if you speak Russian, whatever you speak. The thing is that we like Ukraine, and because we are bored with doing the same thing all the time, we are thinking about new projects, and we would like to do these new projects in Ukraine, like our course in Ukrainian language is a preparation for that, but the idea is that we have already started to prepare the new projects for next year, for starting in September 2018. And I believe that Ukraine, I would very much like that Ukraine is at the center of these new projects. And we also have a very good student there in Chernivtsi, Oksana Ilyuk. Yes, and I ask her what she likes, what topics she likes, and so on. So because we want to do something that has some demand, that is demanded by people, and she said that she likes communication, yes? And I think that's a very important thing. Communication is very important nowadays because you need communication for everything, yes? And Communication is not something that you do extra. It's not like a residual or something that takes you time. Communication is everything. Like in our course, yes, we do communication in this course. But communication is also very important for some of our partners, yes, such as the European Union. The European Union is very interested in communication. And also our friends and neighbors like Russia, they are also very interested in communication. The Ukrainian government is also very interested in communication. Communication is really important. And governments are interested in communication. And also private companies are interested in communication. And they use communication not only for relations with their customers or with their providers, they use communication also in their relations with government. And in the EU, there's a lot of communication going on, because there's communication between businesses and between citizens that try to influence what the European Union does. I don't know if you remember in our first lecture when we discussed about the EU, people know the EU is important and they try to influence the European Union. So they communicate with the EU. And communication always has some basic elements that are common, which is the idea of communication consists in offering information with the purpose, with the intention to influence the behavior of a target audience. So when you are maybe a supermarket and you want to advertise your supermarket, you communicate with your customers or with your potential customers to try to influence their behavior, to try to convince them to shop in your supermarket. This is communication. But also people like us, for instance, like me, we are interested in what the European Union does. And for instance, if I am interested that the European Union spends more money on our projects in Ukraine, I will try to convince the European Union politicians and bureaucrats to try to change their behavior to give money to us. Yes? And this is communication too. Yes? This is what they call lobbying. Yes? And what we study in our courses, we also use it in reality. Yes? So we try to influence the EU. And we try to influence also the EU at election time when there are elections, and we try to influence the EU's behavior. And political parties try to communicate with people, try to compete and communicate. They offer information to people to try to change their voting decisions, to try to get them to vote for them. But communication also happens the other way around. Communication also happens like the EU is also interested in influencing, in changing the behavior of people like me or like you. Yes? And the European Union also has some information activities, information campaigns. In fact, this course, this Jean Monnet open online course that is financed by the EU. I always say that because it's very important for you to know who pays, not only because we are grateful, we are thankful to them. It's also in order to avoid any conflict of interest, in order to be transparent with you. So you know who pays for this course. It's important to know what interest they may have, yes, in paying for this course. So also the public authorities try to communicate with citizens, yes? And There are many names for this. Yes, some names they do not sound well because they are associated to the past or they are associated to different systems. But the modern word, the word that Oksana Ilyuk knows now, likes very much, she likes the word communication. Yes, and the word now, the key word is strategic communication, because it's communication, it's offering information strategically with the purpose of changing the behavior of a target audience. Yes, and we have seen that this communication is not only something that people and firms try to do and try to influence customers, but also try to influence governments. It's also the other way around. Governments also try to communicate in order to influence the behavior of people. They need that for their policies to work many times. They call these information campaigns. Good. But another very important point that you should understand is that the actors and the targets of strategic communication are not only domestic targets or domestic actors. Yes? Those who do strategic communication in Ukraine are not only Ukrainian actors. It's not only the Ukrainian government or not only Ukrainian firms that try to sell their products. They are also foreign actors. Yes? They are foreign multinationals that invest in Ukraine and have their own communication policies. And they are also foreign governments that also try to communicate strategically in Ukraine. And they run information campaigns in Ukraine. These foreign governments include the European Union, include the United States, include Russia. Yes, they all try to have their own communication policies in Ukraine. Also, from a Ukrainian perspective, yes, Ukrainians are not only targets of information campaigns. Ukrainians can also communicate, yes, and can also have their own agenda and can try to sell their projects, for instance, to the European Union, to the United States, to other international actors outside of Ukraine. So the idea is that strategic communication is very important. It happens all the time, and it involves not only the private interest, also public interest, and communication is in both directions, and also it involves international communication. Yes, when you have international communication at the public level, yes, you can call it sometimes diplomacy. Yes, when it's direct contact between government officials of different countries, you call it diplomacy. Yes. But other times you call it propaganda, or if you do not like this word, you can use a euphemism, you can call it public diplomacy. So it's diplomacy oriented to a public audience. So you should understand this, that communication is important, that you should understand communication, that you are now at a university, one of the most prestigious universities in your respective countries, and you should understand communication from a scientific perspective, because communication is happening. Whether you understand it or not, you will not stop communication going on. But it's important, when you understand it, you can even benefit from it. Right, and the case of Ukraine nowadays is a very interesting case, because As you probably know, I don't know, I didn't know very much about this before, but then I discovered that Ukraine is a very interesting country, not only because of its language, not only because of Ukrainian. It's also very interesting because of its culture and because of its history. And Ukraine has been a country that historically has been a battleground of rival empires. Yes? So the Austro-Hungarian Empire, the Ottoman Empire, the Russian Empire, they have always had an interest in Ukraine. Yes? And nowadays it's not something different. Yes? And the methods that you use are very similar now, but they're much more modern in a sense also. But communication is important in this as well. So there is a communication war going on at the moment in Ukraine. Yes? And it's important for you to understand this. But it's important for you to understand your privilege, because this is something of a privilege for you, because it allows you to learn about strategic communication and to learn in the best place where you can learn about it, in Ukraine. Yes? And this is one of the reasons why our next projects should be based in Ukraine, because from a scientific perspective, it's the best place nowadays to know, to understand how strategic communication works. Yes? And I would very much like to do this in Ukraine. I don't know. Yes, maybe my friends in Ukraine do not want me to do that in Ukraine, but I believe this would be important. And as I told you, I'm bored now of doing the same thing all the time. Yes, but at the same time, I see some light, you know, I see some opportunities, a bright future, yes, in Ukraine. And this is just an advance, yes, for you to get to know what things are about. So you should know Ukraine is important and Oksana is important. Yes? Oksana, please remove your mute.
Yes.
Oksana, you like communication, you told me, right?
Yeah.
How about your colleagues there?
What about you guys? What about communication? Like here in Chernivtsi, we have two different majors:
Yes.
international relations
Yes.
and international communication. Like we have two different specializations.
Yes.
So, like, I, Jana, and Dima, we are international communication students, and Marisha and Anya, Anya is there. They are international relations students.
But you know, what we propose is exactly the combination of both things, you know, because strategic communication is important for everything. We said it's even important for a supermarket, yes, or it's important for a political party. But the actors and the targets of strategic communication can be international too, and can be public and can be private. Those who study international relations, probably they are interested in diplomacy,
Yeah.
right? Diplomacy is a form of strategic communication. Yes, it's communication between governments, yes, of sovereign states, yes, but the sometimes those governments also communicate with the people in one foreign country. Yes, I put you some videos. I think you remember about the sanctions on Russia. Yes, and this video is made in Russian language by the European Union External Action Service. Why do they do a video on Russian? In Russian, because they want it for the Russian population. And in this video, they say, these sanctions are not against you, Russians. These sanctions are against your government or against some oligarchs in your government, but not against you. Yes? Because they want to convince the people to change the government. Yes, they say, the EU has nothing against you, it's just against your government. Yes? If you change your government, maybe we will lift the sanctions. It's strategic communication. This is when you can call it public diplomacy. So it's international relations, right? But it's communication. Sometimes people do not use euphemisms. They just use the direct word. This is called propaganda, right? The technical word is called propaganda. Yes? It's a technical word. Maybe when we say propaganda, you think that only Russia does propaganda. No, everyone does propaganda. Yes? The United States, as the major global power, is the one that has more power of propaganda. Russia also has a lot of power. The EU would like to have more power, does not have as much power, but is trying to build also a public diplomacy policy, right? They call it also strategic communications for countering propaganda. They say what Russia does is propaganda, so what the European Union does is not propaganda, is strategic communication to fight propaganda. But we are all grown-ups, yes? And we are students in one of the most prestigious universities in our country. So we call things as they are, yes? And we try to understand them objectively, yes? From different perspectives. Good. I don't know if they see this, maybe the EU does not give us the money for a new project. Maybe we should not publish this, Oksana. No, maybe we write it differently when we write the project, okay? Good. Okay, thank you very much, Oksana. I put you in mute. So today we have a lecture, and today's lecture is about a very, very important topic within our topic, which is economic development in the European Union. And in the last lecture, we discussed about something very, very important, which is the rural-urban duality, or the duality that is that usually happens in developing countries between those areas, usually rural areas, backward areas, subsistence economy, and on the one hand, and on the other hand, those areas that are more urban, more modern, more market-oriented, more developed, yes? And we dedicated one whole lecture to talk about this duality, yes? And we saw the Lewis model and how the process of economic development can be understood as the transfer of people from the rural backward areas to the modern urban areas, yes? We also saw the Harry Stodaro model that explains that this sector, this two-sector model, the Lewis model, may be too simplified, and in fact, in the urban areas, there is also poverty, and it's like a three-sector model that they propose, Harris and Todaro. Yes, that help us understand some current day situations, such as the migrant crisis in the EU, the 2005 migrant crisis. Today's topic is entitled Rural Markets, Land, Labor, Capital and Insurance. So we have seen that there is a duality in poor countries, in developing countries, between urban and rural, yes? And today's topic is about rural areas, how they work, but do not understand rural areas in the sense only about agriculture areas. Yes, usually in developing countries, that's true, that the rural areas are the agricultural areas. But sometimes when you, instead of having a national perspective, trying to understand a country in a globalized world, you can, as we did with the Harris Todaro model, trying to explain migrations from some regions of the world to other regions, what we found is that this Harris Todaro model initially developed to explain intra-country migrations from rural to urban areas could also help us understand migrations from poor regions of the world into richer regions of the world. Yes, migration from Syria and Afghanistan and the Mediterranean countries, the south countries of the Mediterranean, into the European Union. Well, in this case also, when we will discuss the economy of rural areas, the economy of this backward sector of the economy, it can help us understand differences within our country, inside our country. It can help us understand differences inside Ukraine, but it also can help us understand differences inside Europe, for instance, between some regions of Europe and other regions of Europe. So today's lecture is about the microeconomics of the poor regions, yes? That are, in many occasions, they are agricultural, but we should think about them, about the economies of the poor regions, the backward regions, yes? Because in other countries, agriculture, you know, it's very developed. And it's market-oriented, and it's not like that. But we are referring now to the economy of the poor regions. And the title was Rural Markets, Land, Labor, Capital, and Insurance. And we should understand that these markets work differently in rural areas from urban areas. Land, for instance, is a very interesting market. When you study the land markets in the rural areas of developing countries, you realize that they have some institutions that are different from the ones that you would find in urban and more modern developed areas. And for instance, in the case of land, a very interesting topic, sometimes it's a topic for seminar discussion, is the types of contracts that people use for land. Yes? Many occasions, land is not evenly distributed among people. It's not that every person has his or her own plot of land, and there's many cases, yes, in developing countries where land is unevenly distributed, and maybe there's one person that has more land than he or she himself or herself can work. Yes, and what they do sometimes is that they rent this land to someone else. They lend their land to someone else in exchange of a rent, of a payment. Yes, this is very often in urban areas that you rent an apartment. Yes, and what you pay for your apartment, maybe you pay 200 euros per month, yes, in rent for your apartment. But in rural areas, in developing countries, they very often use other kinds of contracts that they are not like a fixed rent contract. They are not like contracts where you have to pay 200 euros per month. No, in rural areas, very often they have a contract that is called sharecropping. And sharecropping consists in the landowner giving the land to a peasant, to a worker, yes? And the person who receives the land and who works the land, instead of paying a rent that is a fixed rent, such as, I don't know, 50 euros per month or whatever fixed rent they agree, no. Very often they use what is called sharecropping, which consists in giving the landowner a proportion of the production of the land. So very often they give them 50%. So what does it mean? It means that there's a landowner gives the land to someone else, this person works the land, and what the land produces, only 50% remains for the worker, and the other 50% is given to the landowner. This is called sharecropping, and it's very common in developing countries. Why do developing regions use sharecropping so much? Yes? This course will try to help us understand this, that later will help us understand many other features about development in Europe that will help us understand also the differences between the different countries in Europe. Yes, differences between Ukraine and Germany, for instance. Yes? But think now about this rural economy, this agricultural economy, where there's this sharecropping contract. Is this efficient or not? Well, when you apply economic science, yes, initially the first idea is that the first impression that you have is that this is not efficient. This is not as efficient as a fixed rent contract. Why is not as efficient? Because when you have a sharecropping and you and there's a land worker, and when you work the land, the problem is that only half of the production will go to you. Therefore, you do not have so much of an interest in production as you would have if 100% of production went to you and you only had to pay a fixed rent. So the incentives are not as strong in sharecropping as in fixed rent contracts. So usually when you have a sharecropping, production is less. Because think about it, maybe It's in the night and there's a heavy rain, and you think, oh, I could profit from this. I would have to go to the land that I have and to channel this rain for my land. But it's night now and I'm tired. I don't know whether I should go or not. If you have a fixed rent contract, all the benefit from doing that will go to you. If you have sharecropping 50-50, only 50% of the benefit will go to you and 50% will go to the landowner. You do not have so much of an interest. Yes? Your incentive is not as strong to work hard, and productivity is less. Yes? So sometimes people say, you know, there's a problem in these developing countries because they use sharecropping instead of fixed rent contracts. Yes? Later we will understand why they do that, and maybe these contracts, they may not look as efficient on the first glance, but afterwards we realize that they have some specific purpose that they fulfill. Yes? What you should understand also is that the people in developing regions are not stupid. Yes? They are as rational as the people in the developed urban areas. Yes? Only that the circumstances where they live are different and their behavior is different, but it doesn't mean that they are irrational. I will tell you a story now. You know, when I went to Romania a few years ago, one of the first times I went there, I went to a rural area, was invited there for dinner. I don't know if I told you sometime. And when I arrived there in this rural area, I was amazed because I saw the house had a parabolic antenna for satellite TV, yes, and they also had connection to the internet and so on. And I was amazed, yes. And I was having dinner there, and I said, suddenly I told my wife, I would like to go to the toilet. And she told me, do you need to go now to the toilet, or you can wait until later? And I said, well, I can wait, but why? Why? I think it's better that you wait. Yes? And then she explained to me, you know, here they do not have a running water in the house, and they do not have a toilet in the house. And if you want to go to the toilet, you have to go outside of the house, yes? And it was snowing. It was like, 20 centimeters of snow. And so, and it's better that you wait. So my initial impression is that these people are so ignorant, yes? They have satellite TV with 40 channels, they have internet, and they do not have a toilet. It means that they are completely ignorant, yes? But that is not true, yes? They are not ignorant at all, they are not irrational at all, yes? What happens is that we look at them from our own perspective, yes? And because in our countries, we used to have toilets and running water first, and satellite TV came later and internet came later, we think that developing countries should follow the same path, the same order of development as we did. But that does not need to be the case. Why? Because we first had running water, and then we had satellite TV, and then we had the internet, because it was when they were discovered. When we had the running water, we didn't have the internet to choose from, yes? But nowadays, yes, they have the internet, they have satellite TV to choose from, and they didn't have that before. And I tell you more, running water, you think of it as a basic thing in developing countries, but it is much more expensive to have running water. The running water infrastructure is much more expensive than what you need to have internet at home. In order to have internet, you just need a very thin cable. Yes? And that doesn't cost very much. But if you want to have running water, you need to have pipes. You know, copper pipes, steel pipes, or whatever material pipes, and you need to bury them so that they do not freeze in winter, and you need a well, and you need the pump for the well, and so on. It's much, 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 much more expensive than satellite TV. Yes? So these people in rural areas are not stupid or irrational. Yes? It's only that in order to understand what they do, yes, we need to know how these developing countries work. Yes? And that's why we have this special lecture today, which is about rural markets, to understand these differences. Yes? When a Westerner, an American, or a Norwegian arrives in Ukraine, they will see many things that will think these people are stupid or are irrational. It's not true. Yes? People in developing countries are much more rational and much more clever many times than the people in developed countries. And they need to use all their rationality just to try to survive in those countries. Yes? So this is very, very important. That will help us understand other things. We discussed already the land contracts. We will discuss now labor contracts. Sometimes when you have more land that you can work yourself, you can not only rent it to other people, yes, with a sharecropping contract or with fixed rent contract. You can also hire workers to work in your land. You can keep your land to yourself and you can hire workers to work your land. Yes? And in this case, if we compare the difference between the case in which you rent the land with a fixed rent contract, or you do sharecropping and the worker keeps 50% of production for him and 50% for the landowner. Or the alternative that you are a worker for the landowner and the landowner keeps 100% of production and you just keep a fixed wage every month. In this latter case, it is the less efficient from the point of view of incentives, because the worker that receives just a fixed wage is not so interested in increasing production very much, because any production increase will go to the landowner, yes? So the main idea is that in developing countries, there are different kinds of contracts, different kinds of land and labor contracts, yes, that may not look so efficient, yes, but then we will try to understand why, yes? Good. I can already give you a hint. Yes? This has to do with insurance. Yes? When you do not want to pay a fixed rent and you prefer a sharecropping contract, many often it's because if you have to pay a fixed rent, it's much more risky. It's riskier, yes? Because if your land does not produce in 1 month, you will still have to pay the fixed rent. And agriculture is a sector that has a lot of risk. It depends on the weather, for instance. What happens if there is a drought? Yes? You still have to pay your fixed rent, and maybe you cannot. And you prefer sharecropping because it's a sort of insurance. Or maybe you prefer even to be a worker for the landowner, where you will only receive a wage, but it's a fixed wage, and you prefer that because you know that every month you will be able to survive. Whatever happens with the weather, whatever happens with the production of the agriculture. So when these people in rural areas, in backward countries, they tend to prefer more some kinds of contracts that we think of them as not being so efficient, increasing production not so much, yes? It's not because they are irrational, or it's not because they do not know economics. It's because with one contract, it's not only a land rental contract, yes? It's at the same time an insurance contract. So they pursue both objectives with the same contract. One of them is insurance, which is very important for the rural areas, yes? Because we will move now to the next element, which is capital. In rural areas, people are poor. And if they are poor, they need more insurance, yes? Because they cannot afford so much risk, yes? This is another factor that when I went to Romania, I was surprised. I saw people, working class people, maybe they bought a car, yes? And they also bought the insurance for the car, a very expensive insurance for the car. That insurance that covers all the risks in the car. And I say, wow, but this insurance is so expensive. I myself do not have it, yes? Because I think it's very expensive. I think I can save money not buying this insurance. And they have it there. Is it because they are irrational? No. It is because they need that insurance. It is because they buy a car, but if they have a small accident with the car, they do not have enough savings, enough capital, enough money to do the repair. In the case of a more advanced country, you do not need insurance so much. If you have an accident and you say, okay, I paid from my savings. But in poor areas, it's different, yes? So this is the idea that capital also is important in these areas and is different. They usually have less wealth per person. We have now 6 simultaneous connections on YouTube. This is one of our records in this course. We have Gabriela Vasiloae from Suceava. We have Floare de Colts. I think she's Cecilia, but she has the nickname Floare de Colts, yes? Cecilia is from the Republic of Moldova. She speaks Russian with the other students in the course that we have. We are in the same course of Ukrainian language and culture, and she knows Russian. So it's a little bit easier for her, but she knows Russian. But I have the capital to buy this book, and I bought this book. And now I will learn faster to try to catch up with her. We also have Irina Strugari, also from Suceava, Cornelia Petrovic from Suceava, Raluca Anna Maria Zaitz from Iași, Georgiana Paduraru from Iași. Good. So we have some people in Chernivtsi, we have people in Suceava, people in Iași. I think these are the three main centers from where our students come from. In the case of Chernivtsi, we could even say that we have two different centers there, because we have one based in the Faculty of Economy and one based on the Faculty of History, International Relations, Communication, and so on. Good. Any questions so far? Christian, Hritskan.
No, not really. Just I was listening to you as you're talking away. It's very true what you said, you know. And it's pity. It's very pity because...
You think this applies to your experience in Romania?
Of course. And I think I might think as well it's the same in Ukraine as well, you know.
We do not know, but you know the good thing about our course is we also have students in Ukraine and we can ask them. Ask them now. My Romanian friends in Chernivtsi. So, in Valentina's group, what was your name? Marisa?
Marisha.
Okay, yes. Marisha. You were the one that he spoke Romanian to?
Da, eu vorbesc român.
Good, Marisha. Okay, Maria, yes, Maria is a Romanian name. So, why is that you speak Romanian? Your family speaks Romanian, or you learned it later? Why do you speak Romanian? It's because you learned at home, it's because your family speaks Romanian, or it's because you learned it at school?
No, because my family speaks Romanian.
Okay, because my family does not speak Ukrainian, you know, but I soon will speak Ukrainian too. Yes? Beginners Ukrainian. Yes? Mm-hmm. Ukrainian. Ucraniana pentru începător.
Da.
Okay, good. So, Cristian Hritskan, he's from Suceava, but he studies at the University of Iași. You know Iași. Do you know where Iași is, right?
No.
Have you been to Iași?
Yeah.
Iași is a very nice place now. It has grown very much, mostly not all of Iași, but in the urban area, in some places, it's amazing. Yes? When you go to Iași, you have to go there to the beautiful part of Iași, the Palace Mall. Yes? Okay, so he said that what I discussed today applies to his experience in Romania. And he thinks that the same could apply also in Ukraine, but I'm not so sure. Do you think that what I have discussed also applies to Ukraine? This idea about land contracts, yes? Or this idea about development, how is it in Ukraine? Do you have sharecropping contracts in the countryside?
Some, yes.
Oh, really? I didn't know. You know, I was afraid that it may not apply there, because sometimes countries, if they have a different history, yes, maybe it's different. How is the land property distributed in Ukraine? Is it very equally distributed evenly among the population? Or is it that there are some people that own very large plots of land and some people who work the land but they do not own the land? Or is it that the state owns the land, you know, like the cooperatives in the past? I don't know how you call them, kolkhoz or whatever, yes? How is the land in Ukraine? Because it's a very important thing for Ukraine, but also for Europe, because Ukraine is the, you know, what feeds us in Europe. It's where the wheat comes from. Yes. So how is land in Ukraine? Who owns the land in Ukraine? Do you know?
It's mixed. People and government. Yeah, we don't have.
So the government still owns the land in Ukraine?
In some meaning, yes, because in order to get, you have to approach the local authorities to get this land.
So, I see. So, wow, this is amazing. You know, it's very interesting to me, you know, to know that in some countries, still, you know, that you have the socialist property of the land, yes? And let's see what happens in the future. So are there also in Ukraine very big landowners or not? Are there some millionaires in Ukraine or some rich people who own very large amounts of land or not yet? Has there been privatization of land in Ukraine?
Yes.
Because, you know, in Romania, for instance, one of the most famous businessmen in Romania, his name is Gigi Becali. And he's a person who became multimillionaire, yes, after the revolution, because he bought land, yes, at that time, he bought large extensions of farmland from public authorities, and then he became a millionaire, yes? I don't know if this has happened in Ukraine too. If there are some people who bought land from the local authorities or from public authorities, and then they also became millionaires.
Some cases, yeah, we had some cases. Maybe not such huge like the millionaires, but like for instance in Chernivtsi region there are a lot of people that did the same.
Mm-hmm. You know that Ukraine joins the European Union, the European Union has a common agricultural policy, right? And this common agricultural policy tries to support farming. It tries to encourage farming, to support it, yes? And it gives subsidies to farmers, yes? And these subsidies, in many cases, they are based on the amount of land that you own, yes? So maybe they give you 100 euros per hectare of land that you have. So the common agricultural policy also may benefit these people who bought a lot of land, who are millionaires and bought land. If you look at the common agricultural policy, there are some of the most benefited from it. They are millionaires sometimes, you know. In the case of Spain, the biggest recipient of subsidies from the common agricultural policy was the Duchess of Alba. Yes, it's an aristocrat in the south of Spain that owned most of the land, and she receive most of the subsidies from the Common Agricultural Policy. But the Common Agricultural Policy is being reformed to try to avoid these things, and it's putting some limits, some caps, like maximum amounts that the same person can receive from the Common Agricultural Policy. I do not tell you the quantities. You can check them on the internet, what the maximum is. Because maybe if I tell you now, maybe you faint there and we have to call the ambulance, right? It's but you check it yourself. Yes, the Common Agricultural Policy, it's something important for Ukraine, because you know that Ukraine is a world power in agriculture. Yes, and it has even greater potential than it has now. Yes, for the future. And we in the Eurosign network, we also have one affiliated university in Zhytomyr. Do you know Zhytomyr? And Zhytomyr has the National Agroecological University there in Zhytomyr. Yes, they're very interested in agriculture, and they even have one specific Jean Monnet course about the Common Agricultural Policy. I don't know if it's the same in Chernivtsi, if agriculture is important in Chernivtsi or not.
Not
so much, yes? Exactly. So we adapt to the different places. But I also ask students, I asked Oksana the other day, she does not remember now. I ask her what.
Let's make the hair. Hello, Diego.
Hi, Carmen. I cannot see you. Hi. I can hear you, but I cannot see you.
Hi.
Hi. I can see you now.
No,
this is Carmen Astase.
Hello, we are.
Hi. Angela Albu from the. Also, some other people besides. Yes. Hello.
Greetings from Slovenia.
Ah, you are in Slovenia now.
Yes, we are in Slovenia.
That's, thank you very much, Carmen, because you have joined today and we can make this experiment with Slovenia.
Yes, we have here partners from Hungary and from Slovenia and also from Finland.
Where are you in Slovenia?
In Catholic University Institute in Ljubljana.
Ah, very good, Ljubljana. And who is from Finland?
It's a
model
showing here.
He
will come immediately.
Mm-hmm. And also we have Paul Tula.
You know when.
And also we have Paul Guban from Edutus College.
Ah, hi. Nice to meet you. Nice to meet you. You know, you said about Finland, and I have good memories of Finland because when I was young, very very young, it was 22 years ago, I did my Erasmus in Finland. I have very good memories of that time as an Erasmus in Finland. Yes, it was very different from Spain, from the region I came from. You know, I can understand now the people who come from Romania to my university in Spain. Yes, and what they see and what the difference they. It's very similar to what I felt in 1995 when I was Erasmus in Finland. Yes, it's with the same year that they had joined, and I liked it very much. Okay, thanks for the experiment, Carmen.
Okay, now just take care of your course.
I put you in mute temporarily. Good, Oksana. So you see that our course is international. Please, Oksana or Marisha, please remove your mute. Hi, Oksana, are you still there? You cannot hear me. Maybe there's not good connection. How about Christian Hritzkan? Can you hear me?
Yeah, loud and clear, loud and clear.
Okay, it's good. Maybe we solve this this problem, technical problems in Chernivtsi. Okay, so we go on, okay? A little bit. We just have a few minutes left and just also one small topic left. Good. So the idea of capital, you know, when capital markets are important everywhere, but in rural areas they are very, very important because people are not so wealthy and they need capital markets to be able to raise the capital that they need to in order to develop. And there are some differences between rural and urban areas, between developing and developed countries as far as capital is concerned. And one of those differences is the fact that capital is much more expensive in the rural areas than in urban areas. Sometimes the interest rates, you know, are 10 times higher in the rural areas than in urban areas. And try to explain this is also a scientific question. It's a question that that economists have tried to explain. Why is it capital more costly? Why interest rates are higher in rural areas than in urban areas? Yes? Inside the same country, in the same currency, inside the same country, if you go to rural areas, they pay much higher interest rates than in urban areas. Why is that? And there are two possible explanations for this, yes? One of the explanations is that in the rural areas, there's greater risk for the lenders. So they need to ask for a higher interest rate to try to cover that risk, yes? And so the risk of default, the risk of not repaying the debt is higher in rural areas. This could explain differences in the interest rates, yes? Because when there's a high risk of default, then you need to compensate for that with higher interest rates that will, in those cases who pay back, will compensate for those cases that default. Yes? So this is the first hypothesis, the first possible explanation. The second hypothesis is that in rural areas, there is less competition. In rural areas, it's not like in urban areas where you can go to a bank and if you don't like it, there's another bank. Besides, you have three or four different banks that compete for lending you the money. There's greater competition. Whereas in rural areas, very often there's just a single provider of credit, which is usually not a bank, but is usually maybe a money lender. Yes, a person who lends money to people. Yeah. So if there's less competition, if you just have one money lender in your village, yes, is usually a rich person of the village that acts also as a money lender. And you cannot go to a different village to ask for credit because the other money lender does not know you, yes? So you have less competition and you need to pay higher prices. This is the second explanation. When you have different explanations for the same phenomenon, how do you choose which one is the good one? It's not the one that you like most, yes? It's the one that fits reality better. Yes, we are positivists. Yes, we test our hypothesis against empirical evidence and we see which ones explain better. And economists have tried to do this and they have tried to explain why interest rates are higher in rural areas than in urban areas. And they tested, for instance, the higher risk hypothesis. And they tested and they looked at the fact that in rural areas, yes, the higher risk hypothesis theoretically could explain the difference in interest rates, but they find that in rural areas, people tend to repay their debts. So it's not true that there's a greater rate of default in rural areas. Yes? So the greater risk of default would not explain higher interest rates. Yes? But there's also a caveat. Yes? And it's the fact that we don't see a great rate of default, but that does not mean that there is not a great risk of default. Yes? Maybe it's that in rural areas, because there's a greater risk of default, the money lenders there need to take greater precautions and to have to make greater efforts to try to recover their debts. And in the end, the rate of default is similar to that in urban areas, but it does not mean that the risk of default is the same for the same effort of the money lender. Yes? So this test is not definitive in order to answer the question. Yes? Also, the other hypothesis then would be the fact that there's less competition, and it's true that there is less competition. And both hypotheses are not incompatible one with the other. Yes, the risk may be greater, and there may be less competition. And sometimes when we look from outside, yes, we may think, okay, then we have the solution. If the problem is competition, we just increase competition in the rural areas. But maybe this wouldn't work in rural areas. Much as like the example I said, that sometimes the first impression when you come from a developed area into a rural one, and you think that this is irrational, this is not working well, and you think you have an easy solution. It's not so easy. Why? Precisely because there is a greater risk of default, the money lenders need to take greater precautions and make greater efforts to try to guarantee that the credits will be repaid. And this very often requires that they know the borrowers very much, yes? And this requires that they have a close relationship with the borrowers. Sometimes the money lender is the owner of the land where you are a worker. And he also offers you an advance, it's like lending you money, yes? But because he knows that you work for him, he knows you, and they have a closer relationship that allows for this. Hi, Kirill. Privy.
Hello. Hello.
We put you in mute now.
Okay.
Good. So the idea is that maybe if you think the solution is increasing competition, if you increase competition, then, hi Lehach, welcome. We put you in mute too. Hey, so many people join today. And we have 7 simultaneous connections on YouTube. Maybe because I said I was bored, yes, at the beginning of the lecture, and people started to join. Thank you very much, yes, for helping. So the idea is that if we increase competition in rural areas, yes, maybe we solve this problem with imperfect competition that we think that would reduce the interest rates, they will reduce the price of capital in these regions, and then we find that it's not the case, yes? Because we increase competition, but then the money lenders are not able to recover the debt so much, the rate of default increases, and then interest rates are high, not because of lack of competition, but because of a greater rate of default, yes? So this is also a very interesting question for debate, yes? Because the answer is not immediate, and try to answer this question forces you to show how much you know about a specific topic. I think we will add, if I have not added it yet, I will add a discussion question about this issue, about why interest rates are higher in less developed areas. And because we said that this course is not only about understanding the economy of a village, which is also important, and because we have a European and a global perspective, this question, I have adapted it for our course, yes? And it can be asked in a sense like, why are interest rates higher in Ukraine than in Germany? And it's the same kind of questions. Why are interest rates higher in Romania than in Germany? Is it because of greater risk of default in Romania? Or is it because of reduced competition in Romania? Because you know that the European Union has freedom of mobility of capital. So capital from Germany could be lent in Romania. Why does capital from Germany do not flow to Romania and equalizes the interest rates between both regions? Yes? Is it because there's greater risk of default in Romania? It's because people would not repay the debts in Romania? Maybe, that's one explanation. You know that there are differences between countries, even between the governments in different countries with public debt, with sovereign debt, and there's a risk premium. Some countries have to pay higher interest rates than others because they are riskier than others, yes? It could happen also for the people in the country that the risk is higher. It could be, yes? Or it could be that in Romania there is less competition, I don't know. But this will be one of the seminar questions. Those of you who are watching, please join the website and participate also in the seminar discussions. Don't leave it for the last moment because there is a point system that rewards your participation on the website. It rewards your attendance, it rewards also your reading, your friends' comments and voting on them. It gives you points also for writing your own comments. Yes, and your colleagues can also vote on them. So if you are taking this course, do not forget to participate on the website. Okay, I think this is all for today's lecture. I thank you all very much for your presence. This has been a special lecture today with people from Chernivtsi, two different groups, with people from Yash, people from Suceava, people from Zhytomyr now, Kirill has joined from there. We have many people watching on YouTube at the same time. Thank you all for your presence. when you watch the video on YouTube, if you like it, please give it a like. And also please leave a comment to the video on YouTube so that we can see that you have watched the video and your colleagues can see how international our course is. Thank you all very much, and see you next week at the same time, 11:30 Eastern European time, for a new lecture of our Jean Monnet Open Online Course of European Integration. See you next week. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.